বিশ্বভারতীর লেকচার সিরিজের 40তম অধিবেশনের আনুষ্ঠানিক আমাদের যে প্রথা, সেই প্রথা মেনে শুরু করার আগে একটি বিশেষ ঘোষণা আমি আপনাদের গোচরে আনতে চাই। এবং আমাদের মধ্যে আজকের এই অধিবেশনের সভাপতিত্ব করার কথা ছিল আমাদের বিশ্ববিদ্যালয়ের উপাচার্য অধ্যাপক বিদ্যুৎ চক্রবর্তী মহাশয়ের, কিন্তু আজকের যিনি আমাদের শিডিউল বক্তা ফরমার চিফ জাস্টিস টিভি রাধাকৃষ্ণন স্যার, জাস্ট আমরা ঘন্টা দেড়েক আগে জানতে পারলাম যে ডিউ টু সাডেন হেলথ ক্রাইসিস স্যার তার গলা দিয়ে কথাই বেরোচ্ছে না। আমাকে ফোনে খুব কষ্ট করে উনি জানালেন যে নিমাই আজকে আমার চেস্ট এবং গলার অবস্থা এত খারাপ, আমি কথা বলতে পারছি না, তো এক ঘন্টা একটা ফোরামে লেকচার দেবো বিশ্ববিদ্যালয় বন্ধন প্ল্যাটফর্মে, আমার খুব লজ্জা লাগছে, তুমি একটু ভিসি সাহেবকে বলো যে আমি জানি না তোমরা কি করে ব্যাপারটা ম্যানেজ করবে, স্যার যদি কোনোভাবে কোনো একটা বক্তব্য দিয়ে অনুষ্ঠানটা ম্যানেজ করেন আমি পরবর্তী স্যারের যখন বক্তব্য রাখার দিন হবে তখন আমি সেই দিন আমি আমার বক্তব্যটা রাখবো। তো আমি তখন স্যারকে বললাম নিরুপায় হয়ে, স্যার এই মুহূর্তে যদি আমরা প্রোগ্রাম ক্যান্সেল করি সকলকে নোটিস করে জানানো, মেল করা, হোয়াটসঅ্যাপ করা বা ফোন করা, তো স্যার তখন কিন্তু জানি না এটা টেলিপ্যাথি কিনা বা সাইকোপ্যাথি কিনা, স্যার সঙ্গে সঙ্গে বলেন ঠিক আছে জাস্টিস স্যার যখন বলেছেন তোমাকে, তো আজকের এই 40তম অধিবেশনের স্যার বক্তা কাম আমাদের সভাপতিও বটে, আমি স্যারকে অনুরোধ করছি। স্যারের প্রচুর মানে গান্ধী রবি ঠাকুর নিয়ে প্রচুর পড়াশোনা, প্রচুর গবেষণা, আমি স্যারকে রিকোয়েস্ট করেছি যে স্যার আপনি একটু যদি আপনার ভান্ডার থেকে গান্ধী সম্পর্কে কিছু কথা আমাদের আজকে শোনান তাহলে আমাদের অধিবেশন চালাতেও সুবিধা হয়, পাশাপাশি আমাদের বাতিল করার সিদ্ধান্তটা নিতে হলো না, আর আজকের এই সমগ্র অনুষ্ঠানটা আমাদের মধ্যে আছেন আমাদের জার্নালিজম মাস কমিউনিকেশন ডিপার্টমেন্টের অধ্যাপিকা মৌসুমীদি। আপনারা সবাই জানেন মৌসুমীদিও আজকে তার শিডিউল পরীক্ষায় ব্যস্ত ছিলেন, জাস্ট 3:40 পরীক্ষা শেষ করেছেন এবং হেলথ ক্রাইসিস মৌসুমীদিরও ছিল, কিন্তু ভিসি স্যারের বা কথা যখন আমি মৌসুমীদিকে বলেছি মৌসুমীদি দ্বিতীয়বার ভাবেননি যে না বলার কোনো স্কোপ নেই, সেই জন্য মৌসুমীদিকেও আমি ধন্যবাদ জানাচ্ছি যে মৌসুমীদি আছেন আমাদের মধ্যে। মৌসুমীদি আমাদের প্রথাগতভাবে সেশন কোঅর্ডিনেট করবেন এবং সুমনদা আমাদের ভাতৃপ্রতিম শুভঙ্কর কৌস্তব জয়দেবদা আছেন, ওনারা যেভাবে আমাদের বেদ সঙ্গীত পরিবেশন করার সেটাও করবেন। শেষে মৌসুমীদি আমাদের যদি কোয়েশ্চেন কিছু চ্যাট বক্স আছে সেটা মডারেট করবেন, করার পরে আমাদের মধ্যে সম্ভবত তারাপ্রসাদ দা আছেন আমাদের শিক্ষা ভবনের অধ্যক্ষ, আমি তারাপ্রসাদ দাকে অনুরোধ করবো শেষ পর্যন্ত থেকে আপনি যদি একটু ধন্যবাদ দেওয়ার জায়গাটা আমাদের দায়িত্বটা নেন তাহলে আমরা খুব খুশি হব। তারাপ্রসাদ স্যার আপনি আছেন? তারাপ্রসাদ স্যার আছেন না? হ্যাঁ 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 স্যার
আছেন।
তো আপনি স্যার শেষ পর্যন্ত থাকবেন এবং আপনি স্যার যেহেতু বক্তা হয়ে গেছেন আপনি ধন্যবাদ জ্ঞাপনের জায়গাটা মিউজিক থেরাপিতেও নেন, এই জায়গায় যেহেতু আমি লাকি এনাফ যে আপনাকে পেয়েছি আমি এই ভারটা আপনার উপরে রাখছি। আর মৌসুমীদি আগে থেকে কথা বলেছেন উনি কোঅর্ডিনেট করবেন, এই বলে আমি সুমনদাকে অনুরোধ করছি বেদ সঙ্গীতের মধ্যে দিয়ে আমাদের অনুষ্ঠানের আমি স্যারের অনুমতি নিয়ে অনুষ্ঠান শুরু করবো। সুমনদা প্লিজ।
নমস্কার। Yeah.
Colleagues of Shongit Bhavana for such a beautiful rendition, which actually motivate us all the time. And yes, good afternoon to everyone, to our Honorable Vice Chancellor Sir, and to Dr. Nimai Shaha, and to all my colleagues, those who have joined here today. This is something which we never expected today, because this topic which was supposed to discuss here, that by Justice T.B. Radhakrishnan, my sojourn amidst turbulence and tranquility, growing up, planning, living and working towards responsible society rooted in universal citizenry. But the thing is that, of course, we here in Vishwabharati, we never stop in working, and we generally do not stop in performing. So that is what our legacy is. And of course, all our faculty and students, we try to follow this. So with this motto, our Honorable Vice Chancellor Sir, so he has kindly agreed to deliver a session. What will be the, obviously that is something, if he wants to speak on Gandhiji, and if we try to connect the insights of Gandhiji towards the topic actually which was supposed to discuss today, so I think it will be a very apt one. So thank you very much, sir, for agreeing to deliver your lecture today. And I don't have much things to say about him, because we all know about our Honorable Vice Chancellor Sir. So I do not want to, obviously, I'm not a person to add anything to that. So Honorable Professor Bidhu Chakraborty Sir, Vice Chancellor Vishwabharati, so I request you on behalf of this the organizers of this 48th Vishwabharati lecture series to deliver your address, sir. So please, over to you.
Thank you, Mohsumi. First of all, I must thank you for having said things which probably I don't deserve. I have a role. Certainly, I perform the role of a Vice Chancellor of Vishwabharati. But on top of it, I have been playing a role of teacher, which will continue to be there even after I demit office of Vishwabharati's Vice Chancellorship. So I think, Mohsumi, if you had introduced me as just a teacher, I would have been happier. Anyway, today I am acting as a substitute batsman because our honorable speaker, Justice T.B. Radhakrishnan, is terribly unwell. Hence, he decided to just not to carry on. And when I came to know about it, I had two options. In fact, the organizer had two options. Either to discontinue and just say, we'll have this later, or just to have somebody as a substitute batsman. I readily grabbed the opportunity simply because I thought this would give me a chance to articulate my persona as a teacher, as a scholar, as an academician. and in front of these illustrious colleagues of mine from this university and elsewhere, it's a rare opportunity for one who has been working on Gandhi on various topics. And if you don't mind, I think a scholar tends to use the those who listen to him as a kind of bouncing board, so that you understand whether your argument is in the right way or whether the conceptual parameters which you have developed are in accord with the process of knowledge formation. So I readily accept it. And before that, I would like to add a disclaimer. Ideally speaking, I wanted to speak in Bangla so that I can reach out to a wider audience. As per our practice, we normally upload this lecture in YouTube. So the moment it is uploaded in the YouTube, many people would like to listen to my views on Gandhi. So I decided to speak in English, though my English is very poor. And I still think that I have learned neither good Bangla nor good English. So I'll try to explain things in what you call tutti-futti English. First of all, I'd like to begin with the topic. My primary question that has been bothering me when I started working on Gandhi, how do I conceptualize Gandhi? My primary concern is to conceptualize Gandhi, because I draw on two assumptions when I study Gandhi. The first assumption is, to me, Gandhi is not a historical figure. Gandhi was a historical figure. He was born in 1869 and killed in 1948. So that's a historical Gandhi. We know about it, that he was born, he went to South Africa, he came back, he organized non-cooperation, he organized civil disobedience. He was one of the leading lights in 1942 campaign. And then he was assassinated by a certain group of political activists. So that's more or less known. To me, the fact that Gandhi is being relevant even today, this 2021 September, August, and we are talking about Gandhi. So what makes him survive even after his death? So that's the question. Here I would like to attribute an expression that my primary concern is not to understand historical Gandhi, because that's relatively an easy job. You focus on the activities in which he was engaged. If you want to understand Gandhi beyond his death in 1948, then you have to think in terms of a different kind of parameter, different kind of category. The conceptual category called civilizational Gandhi appears to be appropriate here. Gandhi becomes part of civilization, human civilization. That's why he is relevant not only in the place of his birth, India, not only during the period when he was active, but also beyond. He is meaningful to the American civil rights activists. He was meaningful to those who fought against racism in South Africa. He was meaningful to the Muslim Brotherhood during the Arab Spring period. He's been quoted extensively. So provokes me to question that how do you understand the continuity of this kind of Gandhi who survived even after his physical existence was sharply cut short. So I make a distinction between historical Gandhi. I'm not interested at the historical Gandhi now. I'm interested in civilizational Gandhi. So my question is how to comprehend, how to understand, how to conceptualize that civilizational Gandhi. That's one assumption which I'd like to pursue. And the second assumption is far more critical, in the sense that, you know, I strongly believe that Gandhi would not have become Gandhi without the presence of his equally illustrious colleagues like Jinnah, like Savarkar, like Ambedkar, like Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore. So, you know, from this, I draw the assumption that Gandhiji was an outcome of the critics, C-R-I-T-I-Q-U-E-S, critics of critics, C-R-I-T-I-C-S. So Gandhiji was an amalgamation, was a kind of blending of many ideas which came to him from Jinnah, from V.D. Savarkar, from B.R. Ambedkar, from Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore. So to me, Gandhi was not a phenomenon. Gandhi was a conceptual category. And that conceptual category is based on a creative blending of manifold ideas, which he derived during the course of his political activism. So these are the two assumptions. The first assumption, that Gandhiji, to me, is a civilizational phenomenon or civilizational figure. And two, Gandhiji was the outcome of critics of critique. And when you talk of the critics, C-R-I-T-I-C-S, I have in mind these four illustrious colleagues of Gandhi: Muhammad Ali Jinnah, V.D. Savarkar, B.R. Ambedkar, and Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore. So from this, you know, I just would like to come to the point that if Gandhi be so, then how do you conceptualize Gandhi? Now there are two ways. I think, you know, Moshumi, just let me know the time constraint, because as you know that when teacher starts talking, so 40 minutes, right?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
After 40 minutes, just let me know, you know.
Sure.
Yeah. So, you know, the question, you know, there are two ways of looking at Gandhi. The first, as I said, Gandhi and his detractors, those who opposed Gandhi during the time when he launched the nonviolent struggle, both in South Africa and literally in India. And then how was Gandhi conceptualized by his colleagues, academic colleagues, during the period he was alive and after he died, after he was assassinated? And, you know, I just follow these two simultaneously. First of all, let me begin with the idea that why is Gandhi relevant? I'd like to begin with this assumption that there are important segments of our life today which doesn't get reflected in our perception. So it means that whatever we see today and whatever we know or derived after having read the ideas of this great man, there is an incompatibility, there is an incongruence. And my purpose today is to understand this incongruence. I'm not saying that this incongruence is difficult to understand. This incongruence is not conceivable. Yes, they are conceivable. I'm trying to understand and explain that incongruence. Here also, I would like to add a disclaimer. You know, normally, when you think of this great man, Gandhiji, Nehru, Jinnah, Savarkar, Ambedkar, you know, there is a tendency among us that we tend to worship them. We'd like to understand their activities in a what I call puja mode, worship mode. But to me, they're all politicians. Gandhiji was a perfect politician, perhaps the most intelligent politician of the 20th century. So to me, Gandhiji was never a Baba. Gandhiji was never a spiritual guru, but a politician with extraordinary intelligence. So to me, he is just an ordinary man like us, with flesh and blood, a mortal human being. But a mortal human being with extraordinary qualities. That's why he became Gandhi. So, you know, please remember these three assumptions. You know, my conceptual parameter happens to be a query to establish Gandhi as a human being, not as a Baba, not as a spiritual guru. Because, you know, I'm saying it, I'm on the basis of the fact that on 2nd of October, if you happen to be in Delhi, and if you decide to go to Rajghat, it's very difficult to get into Rajghat because it's so crowded with all VVVIPs. Now, I raise the question, I mean, do they believe in the fundamental ethos for which Gandhi sacrificed his life? What are those fundamental ethos? Concern, care, empathy, and truthfulness. These are four seminal qualities which Gandhi represented. But you know, just tell me, those who go and pay floral tribute to Rajghat for Gandhiji, do they believe in it? Do they practice in it? I doubt it. So, you know, these are all what is called the you know, attempts to prepare the ground. Now I am coming to the point. As I mentioned, that Gandhiji was conceptualized differently by different people. And as I said at the beginning, Gandhiji as a conceptual phenomenon, as a conceptual category, was an outcome of the critique of critiques. So now I'm developing this assumption to show that Gandhiji was essentially a politician with extraordinary mind, with extraordinary intelligence, with extraordinary mode of thinking. That's why he became Gandhi. That's why he was the one who puzzled the British Empire. That's why he was the one who mobilized the disarmed Indians for nonviolent struggle. Now, so let me begin with the detractors, and then I'll come to the Indian colleagues, Jinnah, Savarkar, Ambedkar, and Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore. Now, the detractors. The first detractors happened to be Jan Smuts. Who was this gentleman? Now, Smuts was the governor of Transvaal province in South Africa. As you know, Gandhiji undertook the first nonviolent struggle against racism in Transvaal in South Africa. And there is an interesting story. Why did Gandhiji decide to go for nonviolent struggle against racism? There is a story, there is an explanation which Gandhiji put forward. Everybody knows that Gandhiji was removed from the first class compartment of a train, which was going from Durban to Pretoria in South Africa. And in the middle of the night, the train, the conductor came and said, there is a sahab, you as Blackie, because Blackies, the Indians were known as Sammy, Kuli, and South Africans, Black African, South Africans were known as Sammy. So he said, you Kuli, because you know most of the indentured laborers in South Africa were Indians and who used to work for, you know, as coolies. So Gandhiji was removed from that first class compartment on the platform. It was a winter, December, cold winter night, terrible minus temperature. And Gandhiji was in two minds. When he was insulted by this white railway conductor, he was very, you know, upset. annoyed and unhappy. What is to be done? The Gandhiji had two options. The first option, he thought, let me go back to Bombay and practice law, and I'm sure, you know, I'll get briefs slowly, and I'll earn a respectable sum to run the family, so that I can avoid this kind of, you know, ill treatment by the white sahabs vis-a-vis the coolies. And the second option, that otherwise let me stay back and fight against racism. And in the morning, you know, if you read Gandhi's autobiography, page number 23, you'll find Gandhi explained. And in the morning, he realized, no, I shall not go back. I'll stay back and I'll fight against racism in South Africa. So a new Gandhi was born. And Gandhi undertook, you know, three endeavors to get rid of racist prejudices of the South African government. The first one, you know, at that point of time, if you are not from South Africa, South African whites, if you are not South African whites, you'll have to pay £25 if you want to exercise your franchise rights. So Gandhi said, this is unfair, this is discriminatory. Because I am from India and I belong to the empire. So I am citizen of the empire, just like white South Africans. So why should I pay extra money to cast my vote? That's my right, democratic right. So there is a big fight, and Gandhiji, you know, fought against this kind of decision in the South African court. He also applied to Privy Council in England. And finally, it was decided that instead of £25, the coolies will have to pay £3. So it was a victory, not entirely, but obviously a substantial victory for Gandhiji, because he fought against this, not through coercion, not through violence, but simply by arguing his case in the court, and also by sending a petition to the Privy Council in London. The second was the Marriage Registration Act. At that point of time, South Africa introduced that if you want to get your marriage recognized, you have to go for registration. Now, Gandhiji thought it was an intervention in their personal life. Because in India at that point in time, even now, in many villages, we don't have registration of marriage. So think of that period, late 19th century. So Gandhi said, you know, I've been married with my wife in the presence of my Mohalla people, and it is socially recognized. And I have been having, I had babies by my wife. So if you de-recognize the marriage now, that means you are claiming that I am staying with my concubine. My wife is now concubine because she was not married as far as your law is concerned. So this law is also discriminatory. This law needs to be banned. So Gandhiji fought against it. Again, through the law court, through sit-in dharnas, before the governor's house. And finally, it was resolved in favor of Gandhiji. Yes, Indians, if they get married and if they can show the proof, and you know, at that in India at that point of time, even today, we invite people through wedding cards. And Gandhiji had given the proof of his wedding card to show that she was married with Kosturba. So that's the second kind of effort. The third effort was when Gandhiji was allowed to practice in South African law court. You know, Gandhiji used to wear a turban. And the judge, at that point, the judge said, you are not allowed to come in with turban, because here you have to come with, you know, that, you know, you must have seen that wig, you know, the wig which the, you know, the lawyers in London, even today, you know, they put on. So you have to put on the hood. I said, Gandhiji said, no, you know, I can't do that because turban is very, you know, is culturally connected with me. Wig is not, wig is alien to me. So Gandhiji did not put on wig, but he was not allowed to put on the turban. He kept the turban outside the courtroom and argued the case. And then he was asked by his friends, why do you do that? Because that's again a submission, you know, to the South African dictation. Gandhi said, no, I gave up turban for the time being because I was fighting for a bigger cause. So, you know, these are three important incidents in which Gandhiji fought and Gandhiji partly won, partly lost. So, and his main enemy happens to be the governor, Jan Smuts. So I'll start with Jan Smuts, you know, assessment of Gandhiji. The first important critique, because he was the one who put Gandhiji in jail several times. Now, Jan Smuts said that, you know, I'm quoting from his, you know, autobiography. It's not published yet. It's available in the Cambridge South Asian Library. It was my fate to be antagonist of a man for whom I had the greatest respect. I must frankly admit that his activities at that time were very trying to me because Gandhi raised a troublesome issue. What is the troublesome issue? Racism. Now, racism is discriminatory simply because of accident of birth. And racism laid one group of people as exploiters at the cost of the exploited. So, you know, it was an attempt to divide humanity on the basis of certain artificial criterion. And one of them happens to be certainly the physical might of the European powers. So Jan Smuts, when he wrote this autobiography, he was in his 80s. And he realized that it was Gandhiji who raised a very appropriate issue at that point of time. But because of his commitment to the government, he could not agree with Gandhiji. He had to take all kinds of worship measures to let Gandhiji down. Yet he appreciated the man simply because he was for universal humanism. So you see, the Gandhi's fight for universal humanism was something which was appreciated by his greatest enemy in South Africa, Jan Smuts. So this is something which he wrote in 1914, when Gandhiji was in South Africa. Gandhiji left South Africa in 1914. And just before Gandhiji left, Gandhiji went to see him. And you know, you'll be surprised to know that Gandhiji gave him a pair of chappal. And you may also interpret this chappal was nothing but a kind of, you know, an abuse or a slogan of abusing Jan Smuts. No. Because Gandhiji said, you gave me rigorous imprisonment. And during imprisonment, I prepared these two chappals for you. And Jan Smuts immediately replied that, yes, but do you think I can fit into your shoes? And then he also made another statement that India gave me Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi. I gave you Mahatma Gandhi. This is Jan Smuts, 1914. Now let me come to 1918, another detractors. Now this gentleman, he is a young Irish guy. He was appointed district magistrate of Champaran. And you know, in 1914, when Gandhiji reached India, he was asked by Gopal Krishna Gokhale that you please first know the country and then you get involved in national politics. So between 14 and 17, Gandhiji moved around the country. And in 1918, when there was a campaign against the indigo planters in Champaran, Gandhiji was invited by Rajan Prasad Shukla. He was from Champaran. He was leading a campaign against the indigo planters. And then Gandhi came and Gandhi fought it. But you know, that's not important to me. The important point is the point of the detractors. And these detractors happened to be the district magistrate of Champaran, a young Irish guy, Terence Root. And Terence Root was asked by his superior officer to go to the station and control mob. This guy was very surprised. He said, you know, who is this gentleman for which I have to go to the station and control mob? You know, he couldn't believe it. But he went to the station and he found out that the station was full of people. And you know, he was really surprised that people from all over the places in near Champaran, they came. Some came by on foot, some came by bullock cart, some came by cycle, but you know many people in the station. So he was really curious that who is this gentleman for which so many people gathered. But he couldn't see it. Because Gandhiji was very short, 5'3" height and very frail health. So he couldn't locate Gandhiji. He was encircled by people when he got off the train. And then afterwards he said that, I couldn't believe it. That here is a man, an Indian, a black Indian. He was so popular that he could magnetically attract people from all over the places. Then he said, why? Then he said, probably he transfigured the imagination of the people. And he appeared to them as a liberator. You know, they were all subject to indigo planters' exploitation. You know, the Teen Kathiya system. That, indigo plantation, you have to grow indigo in 2/3 of your land. And 1/3 is meant for producing rice, wheat, or your, foodstuff. So Gandhiji opposed it. And, this particular satyagraha is different from all other satyagraha which Gandhi undertook. And people don't know. This satyagraha took place without any sitting in dharna, without any slogan, without any bhook hartal. Gandhiji asked all the people in Champaran who suffered due to indigo plantation to write a petition and submit it to the court. And altogether, 810 petitions were submitted to the court, local court in Champaran, and Gandhiji argued for the exploited cultivators, and he had won. So his satyagraha here is not based on dharna, is not based on slogan, but is based on the petition and the argument which he put forward before the judges, and he won. And the Teen Kathiya system was abolished in Champaran. So you see, the young district magistrate Champaran, he realized that here is a man who was capable of transfiguring, radically changing the perception of those who were involved in abolishing the indigo plantation. So 1921, another detractors. Here, the detractors has got more authority. He happens to be the viceroy himself, Lord Reading. And in 1921, that non-cooperation movement was about to begin. So the British authority wanted to negotiate with Gandhiji. And then he was given an appointment to the viceroy. and he went. And Viceroy's office was today's Rashtrapati Bhavan. He went to Viceroy's residence come office, and as usual, you know, when you see a person of his type, you know, with dhotis, with very, you know, unkempt kind of, you know, dress, typical Indian, you know, cultivator kind of dress. So he was stopped. "Where are you going?" He said, "You know, I have an appointment with the governor, Viceroy. So please allow me." And at that point, the security system was not so rigid. So he was allowed. And finally, two, three times he was stopped, and then he expressed his identity, and then he was allowed. And now he said, "You know, I went inside the room where Viceroy was sitting in front of in a chair at the edge of a table, huge table. Gandhi stood there for a while, and the Viceroy didn't notice. After a point of time, the Viceroy noticed and said, 'Who are you? Why are you standing here?' He said, 'You know, I am Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi. I had an appointment with you.' 'Okay, okay, please sit down.' So they had discussion. And then later on, he wrote this in his autobiography. He said that if I saw him outside, I would have ignored him as an ordinary Indian. I would have ignored him as any ordinary Indian, because there was nothing striking in his appearance. Because there is nothing striking in his appearance. But when he talks, the impression was different. When he talks, the impression was different." So this is Lord Reading, detractors. So, you know, I'm trying to build up the story from the detractors. Now, those who supported Gandhi, those who were Gandhi's admirers. Here, I'll refer selectively to some of the European admirers. Those who read about Gandhi, they know that Gandhi's biography, you know, and now there are millions. But the first biography was written by his friend in South Africa, who was a priest of the biblical church, George Doke. But that biography is not, you know, available. I tried my best even in Johannesburg to get hold of that biography, but I got part, not the full. But one of the widely accepted biography and standard biography of Gandhiji happens to be written by Rama Rama, the Nobel laureate literature of France. So Rama Rama wrote a book, the name is Mahatma Gandhi. And in that particular book, he said, this is the man who stirred 3 million people to revolt, who has shaken the foundation of the British Empire, and who has introduced into human politics the strongest religious impetus, of the last 2000 years. Now, this is very important, this part. And then, you know, I'm building up Gandhiji as a conceptual parameter. Rama Rama said, yes, it is very striking that Gandhiji stirred 30 crores of Indians. Gandhiji shook the foundation of the British Empire. But on what basis? Then he said, on the basis of critical religious beliefs of Christianity. Ramananda was a devout Christian, just like Leo Tolstoy. Now, what are those two critical beliefs? Infinite patience and infinite love. So Ramananda argued that it is Gandhiji who understood the core values of Christianity, infinite love and infinite patience. Now, Satyagraha is being built. If you dissect Satyagraha as a mode of action, you'll find it comprises two things. One, patience. And second, self-inflicted pain. You will win over the enemy by inflicting pain in yourself. That's absolutely the idea of New Testament, the Sermon on the Mount. So Ramanala said, it is Gandhiji who articulated the Sermon on the Mount, not merely as a conceptual category, but also as a mode of action, as a mode of bringing people for a cause. In other words, he was trying to execute the idea of the Sermon on the Mount vis-a-vis humanity. It was not merely a New Testament instruction. It was also an attempt to articulate humanity in practice. So Gandhiji did nothing unusual, because what he did was to bring back the forgotten memory. The forgotten memory about infinite patience and infinite love. And he built his weapons for nonviolent struggle on the basis of these two forgotten instruments of the New Testament. Then I'm coming to 1948, after his death. A famous scientist, Albert Einstein. He was also an admirer. But his admiration is also based on certain critical assumption. You know, when we appreciate somebody, I said, he's very good. When you question somebody, you said, he's terribly bad. But we don't explain why he is good, why he's terribly bad, or why she is good, or why she is terribly bad. But Albert Einstein, a scientist, he assessed Gandhiji on the basis of his critical faculty. So he appreciated, but on the basis of a scientific understanding of what did Gandhiji represent. What was Gandhiji? Gandhiji was a human being, true. But at the same time, he was the one who articulated many ideas. So Albert Einstein, after having understood Gandhiji from his scientific point of view, expressed his admiration by saying, generations to come will scarce believe that such a one person like Gandhiji has walked the earth in flesh and blood. Now, Gandhiji, as you know, is the one who fought against the mightiest empire of the 20th century, British Empire, non-violently. Now, even today, you know, given the kind of, you know, what is called atrocities, it is difficult to conceptualize human existence without being violent. Now, violent does not necessarily mean hitting somebody. When I am bullied verbally by the local political leaders, it's also violence. So that's why, you know, I keep on referring to this share with those who are, you may have heard about it. That, you know, Gandhiji's Hindustan and today's Hindustan are radically different, simply because the idea which Einstein pursued doesn't seem to be relevant in today's context. So, you know, I explained it in terms of a small कपलेट। ये राम का धरती है, ये राम का धरती है, मर्यादा कहां? ये मर्यादा पुरुष राम का धरती है, मर्यादा कहां? ये भगवान कृष्ण का मिट्टी है, प्रेम कहां? ये भगवान बुद्ध का तपोवन है, शांति कहां? सब परिवर्तन हो गए, सब परिवर्तन हो गए, युग परिवर्तन का साथ, युग परिवर्तन का साथ। इससे कब छुटकारा मिलेगा, इससे कब छुटकारा मिलेगा? तो इसी मेरे हिसाब से, इन माय परसेप्शन, आइंस्टाइन पुट फॉरवर्ड ए पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू व्हिच कंटिन्यूज टू बी रेलेवेंट इवन टुडे, सिंपली बिकॉज द मोड इन व्हिच गांधीजी developed his Gandhism doesn't seem to be relevant in today's context, simply because we have changed so radically. We talk about it, we organize seminar on this, we organize political procession on this, we justify many things in terms of Gandhiji, but when it comes to practice, we hardly pay any attention to the fundamental ethos on which Gandhism rests or is based. What are those fundamental ethos? I talked about already. Care, concern, empathy, and truthfulness. So this is, I think, all about the Gandhi's admirers. Now I'd like to focus on the Indian detractors. Moshi, what time is it?
Sir, 40 minutes have already crossed. But of course...
What time will you give me?
I guess you can take at least 10 more minutes.
Okay, 10 more minutes will be enough.
Then you, of course, when you continue, sir.
Achha. Now, I'm going to say a fundamental point. Now, I'm coming to India now. We just moved around the world and come to India. And I made the argument that Gandhiji was the product of critics of critique. And I referred to Tagore, referred to B.R. Ambedkar, referred to V.D. Savarkar, and finally, M.A. Jinnah. Now, I'll just briefly refer to everybody's critique except detailing Rabindranath Tagore. Because since we are all acquainted with Tagore's ideas. Now, when you think of Jinnah, and you know that, let me just also make it a point that there are four individuals, three, who did not address Gandhiji as either Bapu or Gandhiji. They addressed him as Mr. Gandhi. One, Jinnah. Second, Savarkar. Third, B.R. Ambedkar. Now, Savarkar, to me, is being misunderstood. If I talk about it, then people immediately club me with RSS, BJP, etc. I am saying it on the basis of my academic understanding of Savarkar's writings. And those who are interested may read this book, which I just have published, Gandhiji versus Savarkar, Jinnah, and Ambedkar. And here, I wrote about extensively on Savarkar's understanding of India then. Now, Savarkar, as I said, has two phases. The first one is hardcore nationalist. And the second one, I club it as rational nationalist. Now, if you talk of the first phase, I think I would request you to read his text called 1857: The First War of Independence. He's the one who first of all characterized the so-called Sepoy Mutiny as the First War of Independence. And he's the one who appreciated the battle in which Hindus and Muslims fought together against a common enemy, the British. This is the nationalist Savarkar, hardcore nationalist, because he was part of Anushan Samiti. And you know that Gandhiji wrote Hind Swaraj after having talked to Savarkar, because Savarkar said, your non-violence is of no use, you have to resort to violence. And then he tried to pursue them that please don't believe in violence, please have faith in non-violence. Anyway, that's a different story. Rationalist Savarkar is usually defined in terms of his text called Hindutva. Now, I have the book, although I thought of, you know, quoting from the book extensively. This is a very small book. It's about 140 pages. And those who are interested to read about Hindutva and Savarkar, please go through this book and then have your own opinion processed. Don't go by interpretation. I'm not an admirer of Savarkar. You know, as an academic, I try to be as objective as possible. And here, you know, Savarkar wrote extensively on the essentials of Hindutva. If you read this section, I'm not going to, you know, read it for you, but I'll just summarize. In Savarkar's perception, Hindutva never ever entailed only the Hindus. He said, those who live in Hindustan, now those who are aware of etymology of Hindustan, they know it has nothing to do with Hinduism. It is clearly a geographical expression coming to India from the Greeks. Greeks could not pronounce Sindhu as Sindhu. On the contrary, they pronounced Sindhu as Hindu. So those who lived on the bank of the Hindus, means Sindhus, were all Hindustanis. And Savarkar argued that we are talking about a geographical entity called Hindustan, where people belonging to different religion lived. So this essentials of Hindutva is clearly an attempt to define Hindustan or define Hindutva in secular terms. If there is a question, I'll elaborate on that. Now, what brought him against Gandhi? Because Gandhi's mode also was class collaboration, caste collaboration, religious collaboration. Strategically, fantastic. But in practice, it didn't happen. If you think of non-cooperation movement, Gandhiji brought the Muslims not with reference to non-cooperation slogan, but with reference to Khilafat slogan, which was clearly a religious driven slogan, because the British abolished Caliph in Turkey. So the Muslims were very unhappy. So they wanted to attack the British. So Gandhi said it's strategically good to espouse their cause as well. So Gandhiji's strategy of bringing people together did not impress Savarkar, because Savarkar said, instead of identifying them as groups, Hindus, Muslims, Christians, Sikhs, we are all part of the same country, which is geographically united. So Gandhiji, Savarkar differed from Gandhiji by simply suggesting that instead of dealing with them or identifying them as separate entity, please try to bring them under one platform as Hindustan. And Savarkar was correct. Because if you look at 1932 Roundtable Conference, three conferences took place. The first conference was attended by Gandhi, but Jinnah wasn't there. Second conference was not attended by Gandhi, Jinnah was there. And the third conference was attended by Gandhi, Jinnah was there. 32 Roundtable Conference, the idea which Savarkar, you know, developed and tried to pursue, became true. Jinnah insisted on the specific identity of the Muslims. As a result, what he did, what he gained? He gained separate electorate through communal award. So what Savarkar hinted at in 1920s became true in 1931-32. So Savarkar, to my mind, was the one who acted as a change, what is called a corrector of the movement, was a path correction design. Savarkar was a path correction design. But somehow or the other, it did not, you know, click with Gandhiji, or Gandhi didn't accept it. Because Hindutva at that point was distorted as an ideology of only Hindus. You know, I'm questioning. In my book, I raised this issue. That is a wrong interpretation, a disservice to Savarkar. You may not agree with him, but at least insofar as Hindutva was concerned, that was absolutely a secular conceptualization as far as I am concerned, and I dealt with it in my book. So Savarkar contributed to Gandhian idea of segregating the Hindus from Muslims or Muslims from Hindus. That it was wrong, it was hinted by Savarkar very clearly in the mid-1920s with the publication of this particular book. The second point comes Jinnah. Now, Jinnah was very critical of Gandhi from the very beginning. Jinnah never liked Gandhi, though he was a member of the Congress Party. But Jinnah's difference of opinion started with Gandhiji from the Roundtable Conference. Interestingly, Gandhiji opposed separate electorate for the Dalits, but Gandhiji did not oppose separate electorate for the Muslims. He said, I'll try to persuade them. Please don't accept separate electorate. Don't divide the countrymen. But that didn't, I mean, Gandhiji knew that Jinnah was a strong personality, staunch, you know, staunch supporter of Hindu-Muslim divide. So he will not accept. But Gandhiji imposed his will on the Dalits. Ambedkar, the Dalits were also given separate electorate by the McDonald ministry. But Gandhi said, don't divide Hindus further between the caste Hindus and the Dalit Hindus. Here, you know, the critique part I'm arguing, there are, you know, I just, because of positive time, Gandhiji was critiqued very severely by Ambedkar in many ways, but it's no point, you know, talking about all those many ways, and those who are interested, they can read the book. I just refer to two important references. The first is a letter which Ambedkar wrote to his wife on February 8, 1948. Remember the date, February 8, 1948. Gandhiji was assassinated on 30th January, 1948. So this particular letter was written immediately after Gandhiji's assassination. And this particular letter is very significant to me. From the fundamental assumption which I wrote, which I, you know, drew at the beginning of my lecture. He said, no, he was keen. You know, I let me tell the story and then I'll come to the point. Once he came to know about Gandhiji's death, he was keen to see Gandhiji's dead body. His wife, Savitaji, second wife, was a doctor, was Ambedkar's doctor. She was very surprised. How come? You know, Gandhiji was dead and Ambedkar was keen to see the dead body in Birla House. And that time the transport was not so easy in Delhi. And he used to stay in Rajpur Road in Old Delhi. And Gandhiji's body was kept in New Delhi Birla House. But she was keen. But he went and he couldn't see the body. because they, that time nobody knew Ambedkar. So nobody gave any space to Ambedkar to see the body of Mahatma Gandhi. He came back home. He was very upset. And Savitaji asked him, what happened? He said, I went to see the body, but I couldn't. And the next day, the cremation was to take place. Again, Ambedkar insisted. And that time, Ambedkar was terribly unwell because he was a patient of high diabetes. His wife said, please don't go. He said, no, I'll go to Yamuna Bank where the body will be put on pyre. So Ambedkar went and saw that the body was put on the pyre and the, it was set on fire. He came back very happy. Savita was again upset. You know, how is it possible? Mahatma is dead and you are happy. Then Ambedkar said, Savita, I am very happy today. He said, why? Because with Gandhiji's death, Babadom in Indian politics will disappear. Indian politics will be far more rational with the absence of Gandhi from the Indian political scene. This is the fundamental point. That, you know, he was a rationalist. A rationalist who wanted to establish political democracy in the Western mold. Because he was, you know, ideologically baptized in America under the instruction of John Dewey in at Columbia. And then he came to LSE and did his PhD at the LSE. So he was a product of typical Western liberal system. So he was always keen to establish liberal democracy. Unlike Gandhian village Swaraj. His point was very clear. He said, you see, you are talking about casteism. Now, casteism is very important and significant in the villages. In town, you don't know. But in village, there is a Bhaktipara. In their village, there is a Dompara. In village, there is a Brahmanpara. In village, there is a Kayasthopara. So, you know, it is segregated in village. So how can you think of good governance on the basis of village republic? So Ambedkar was critical of village republic from the very beginning, simply because village is the custodian of caste system. In town, in Bolpur town or in Kolkata, do you know where people belonging to Bhakti caste live or people belonging to Brahmin caste live? No. So town is caste free in a, to a significant extent than the villages. So Ambedkar again critiqued Gandhi's insistence on village republic. And this particular point was well elaborated in his last speech in the Constituent Assembly on 25th of November 1949. Those who are interested, you can see it in the Google search. Ambedkar's last speech on 25th of November 1949. After that, Ambedkar closed the Constituent Assembly debate and we got the Constitution. And there are this particular, you know, speech is very important as critique of Gandhi. He argues that, you know, we are very proud that parliamentary democracy, when you talk of parliamentary democracy, we tend to draw on the Western examples. That as if parliamentary democracy came from the West. He questioned that. On the basis of his study, he argued that Buddhist Bhikshu Sanghas are nothing but parliament in its embryonic form. And he said, before West knew about all these things, the Buddhist Sangha, especially Lichavi democracy, you know that. He referred to it in that particular speech. The idea of motion, the idea of resolution, the idea of sitting arrangement, the idea of rules, the idea of regularization, the idea of nota, everything was present in the functioning of the Buddhist Sangha. He said, if you look at Jatak stories, you'll find many references of how parliamentary system functioned. They had a different word, Sangha. How did Sangha function? This Sangha is nothing but the replica of parliamentary system of government. So we had parliament. We had parliament, yet we lost it. Now we got the democratic constitution. Are you going to lose it? Then he said, you know, there are possibilities. And he said, because one, Babadam, Gandhiji became Baba. Nobody was critiquing Gandhiji at that point of time. And second point, he said that the two important characteristics of parliamentary democracy happen to be equality and fraternity. Now in India, equality is absent. We have got political democracy. Everybody has got one vote. Whether you are a rickshawwala, whether you are a professor, or you are Ammani, or you are anybody else. But when it comes to economic democracy, we are highly disparate. We are highly segmented. So how can you say it's democracy? It's not democracy. That's one. And second, fraternity. Now, fraternity is one of the fundamental principles of political democracy. But so long as caste remains, we cannot think of fraternity, because caste is anti-national. Even today, in North India, I don't know whether it happens in Bengal, North India, there are many examples. If there is an inter-caste marriage, if upper caste Hindus marry a Dalit girl, they are killed. Even today. So fraternity is an impediment, serious impediment, so long as caste division remains. So caste division, instead of giving up, instead of doing away with divided self, is actually consolidating divided self. So how do you expect to have fraternity? And the third, he said, the idea of great man. The moment you have a great man in front of you, you tend to surrender. He said, great man knows everything. It's happening. You know, in Indian, contemporary Indian politics, I should not mention the names. The political boss happens to be the godly figure. No discussion in the cabinet, in parliament, it's gone, it's done by the political bosses. He said, in bhakti, complete surrender to God is good, because it allows you to have moksha, salvation. But in politics, if you completely surrender yourself to the boss, it leads to dictatorship. It leads to authoritarianism. Now, these points, if you take them together, these points are all directed against Gandhi. These points are all directed against the omnipresent political leadership epitomized by Gandhi. So if you read this particular speech today, you'll find its relevance even today. So this is Ambedkar. We talked about Jinnah, Savarkar, Ambedkar. Now I'll come to Gurudev. Now Gurudev, if you look at Gurudev's discussion, I'm just doing a book on that. Now, if you look at Gurudev's discussion, because of positive time, because Moshumi is looking at me, staring at me, just stop it. So I'll try to finish it as quickly as possible. Now, if you look at Gurudev's writings, I just make 2-3 submissions. Now, as you know, Gurudev nurtured scientific bent of mind, always. But at the same time, he admired Gandhiji. Had he born today, had Gandhiji born today, probably they would not have talked to each other. They would have become enemies to each other, because the way they criticized each other. But it was at that point of time, both of them were noble minds. So they understood their point of view, and they respected the differences. Now, appreciation. Gurudev, if you look at Gurudev's writings on Gandhiji, you know, I wanted to read this, Gurudev's poem. In Bangla, Gandhi Maharajer Shishyo, Keuba Dhoni, Keuba Nishyo, Ek Jagay Ache Moder Mil, Gorib Mere Bharaina Pet, Dhonir Kache Hoina Het. তারপরে বলছেন একটা জায়গায় ওই কবিতার শেষের দিকে, দলে দলে হরিণ বাড়ি চলল তারা গৃহ ছাড়ি, ঘুষলো তাদের অপমানের সাপ, চিরকালের হাত পরি যে ধুলাই খসে পড়ল নিজে, লাগলো ভালে গান্ধীজির ছাপ। হি রোট এ বুক, ইট টেক্স, অ্যান্ড ইউ নো দ্যাট ইন 1932 ওয়েন গান্ধীজি ওয়াজ অন হাঙ্গার স্ট্রাইক, গান্ধীজি আস্ট টেগোর টু গো টু পুনে. And then, you know, he sang a song. I forgot the song, a very favorite song, which Gandhiji liked. He sang a song and took a glass of orange juice from Gurudev. So Gurudev, you know, if you look at this particular poem, I see two important points which come out of it. He said it was Gandhiji who tried to bring about a radical change in the prevalent social cultural mindset, a mindset which was divisive on the basis of the accident of birth. So Gandhiji that way was a revolutionary who radically altered the approach to humanity by questioning the basis of segregation in terms of caste. So his first point of admiration is based on Gandhi's conception of humanity being an undivided identity. That's one. The second point, he said that Gandhiji was the one who, through persuasion, was able to mobilize people around him for a cause, for a politico-ideological cause. He knew that mere political freedom was not exactly appropriate to radically alter the prevalent social cultural prejudices in India. But that's important, because once we have power to ourselves, probably we'll be able to adopt laws, regulations, will be able to adopt the system of governance to get rid of this kind of divisive existence of humanity. So Gandhiji had the capacity to mobilize people regardless of social cultural distinction. These are the two points of admiration, and it's written extensively in his text. But at the same time, as I said, Gurudev, with his scientific bent of mind, did not appreciate Gandhiji uncritically. Example, 1934 earthquake. 1934 earthquake in Bihar. Many people got killed. And Gandhiji made a statement that earthquake took place as God's caprice, which means God became very angry with humanity. As a result, earthquake took place. Gandhiji made that public statement. Gurudev was terribly angry. He said, you know, Gandhiji, you are Gandhiji. How come you make this kind of irresponsible statement? Because you know, earthquake takes place because of certain geological changes underneath the surface of the earth. And if you, as Gandhiji, if you convey this kind of idea to the people at large, people will start believing. Then there was a little exchange of letters between Gandhiji and Rabindranath Tagore on this particular event. Since I don't have time, otherwise I would have quoted extensively. But the main point I'm just summarizing. And he said that you can't do that. Because you are Gandhiji, you are not Tom, Dick and Harry. So when Gandhiji made a statement, people would take it very seriously. So you should be careful when you make a statement. But Gandhiji said that my purpose was different. I knew that it was a geological, you know, development. Yet I said it simply because I wanted to make people, those who are practicing untouchability, scared of God's intervention. As you know, in Hindustan, everything can be done through God. Otherwise, you know, this Babadam would have disappeared by now. You know, when there is a cholera, you know, people tend to offer puja to somebody, to a deity. When there is malaria, when there is smallpox, you know, there are some god and goddesses, their market becomes very important. Suddenly becomes, you know, very, they become very highly marketable simply because the superstition. So Gandhiji as a politician, that's why I say Gandhiji was a politician. Gandhiji as a politician wanted to utilize that weak point of human mind to convey his ideological point against untouchability. So, you know, from this, what I wanted to argue that Tagore appreciated Gandhiji on a number of occasions because of the point which I made a few minutes ago. But at the same time, Tagore did not accept Gandhiji on the because of his superstitious belief. But Gandhiji had his point. Gandhiji had his own argument because he was a politician. He was a politician. He wanted to get things done. His main purpose was to win political freedom. But Gandhiji's main purpose was to win political freedom. But Tagore's purpose was to bring about universal humanism. So they had different ideological goal. And for Gandhi, this kind of, you know, unscientific statement was highly probable. But for Gurudev, it was not, because it was an attempt to befool the humanity. So, you know, I mean, just concluding. Now, the basic point which I'm trying to argue here, that Gandhiji became Gandhiji because of the contribution of these illustrious colleagues, both abroad and from within the country. So in order to understand Gandhiji as a civilizational figure, one needs to take into account these ideological views and beliefs. Only then you'll be able to understand or comprehend Gandhiji as a phenomenon. Because to me, Gandhiji is not just a human being. It's more than that, because he's the one who developed a unique conceptual category to establish humanity, obviously different from that of Tagore, different from that of Savarkar, Ambedkar, but at least he had his own unique conceptualization of humanity. And he did it by being accommodative of some of the ideas which he derived from his colleagues and from his detractors. Thank you very much, friends. You gave me enough time. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Actually, our moderator has got very little thing to do after such a luminous speech, that too on prim humanism. So as a moderator of the session, and of course as a listener to such a speech, such informative speech, my take on this entire session is that basically our honorable speaker, sir, he discussed about many illustrious people, including Gandhiji, of course, being the main person. But basically, he tried to show us different perspectives of supreme humanism, which is very important for today's world. Sir, thank you so much for such information. And I think, basically, Dr. Nimai Shah, I would request you to organize series of lectures on these, because of course it's very difficult to complete this thing in a short lecture. Sir, we have got few questions. So I would request you if you can, not only questions, few observations. So it would be really kind enough, like if you can address those questions.
Sure.
Thank you, sir. So PhD scholar Monisha Raut from Agronomy Department, she has written, what would be the easiest way to arouse a Gandhi within us? Her question is in context to the present violent, impatient young generation.
You know, ki naam bolle?
Manisha Raut.
Manisha, you know, if I want to respond to your question in detail, I have to give another presentation of 40-45 minutes. I'm sure Moshumi will not allow me to carry on like that. So I just would like to, recite small poem of Harivansh Rai Bachchan to respond to your answer, how to arouse Gandhism in us. According to Harivansh, I don't remember the exact the full poem, but some of the lines I remember. And I think if you take down this particular part of this poem, you'll be able to probably find answer to your question, how to arouse Gandhism or how to build Gandhism in yourself. जब मंदिर में पुजारी को रहीम नजर आएगा, जब मस्जिद में मुल्ला को राम नजर आएगा, जब मस्जिद में मुल्ला को राम नजर आएगा, दुनिया का सूरत बदल जाएगी, दुनिया का सूरत बदल जाएगी, जब इंसान को इंसान में इंसान नजर आएगा, जब इंसान को इंसान में इंसान नजर आएगा। इर मानेटा होच्छे एटाई, जे when you think of Ram in a mosque, when you think of Rahim, Allah, in a temple, then the entire universe will be changed. But that's possible only when you recognize a human being as humane. Only then you have this kind of perception. So today's violent world, to me, doesn't seem to be receptive to these ideas. You have to think in terms of your neighbor, your friends, regardless of sex, class, and gender, as one of you. And then you will appreciate those four feature characteristics that which I have mentioned: care, concern, empathy, and truthfulness. So if you practice these things, care, concern, empathy, and truthfulness, I'm sure in course of time, you will have Gandhism aroused in yourself. Thank you.
Thank you for asking this question. I guess the next question of Orpita Pal is also in the same tune from Department of Japanese. So Orpita, I guess you have also got your answer. And there is a small incident by I could not read the entire name. So there's a question, sir. What fascinates, not question actually, observation, then a question. What fascinates me about Gandhiji as a leader is that he constantly keeps learning, unlearning, in other words, keeps the experiment on. So recently there has been the protest in some parts of Africa. Of course, it was not in Africa. She corrected it later, California. So, and his statue was removed because he is now being identified as a racist. How would you see evolution of his ideas as far as racism is concerned?
No, Monisha, in fact, I was tempted.
Someone else asked this question.
Okay. I'm sure any of those person who asked this question, I was tempted, Moshumi, to refer to an incident. I think she got confused Yes, there was a campaign in California, but the statue was removed from Ghana University. There is a statue of Gandhiji, which was inaugurated by our former president, Pranab Babu, in front of Ghana University. And then there was a campaign against him, against this, and the statue was removed, I think, last year probably. Anyway, I'm glad that you wanted to know about it. In fact, you know, if you want to know about it in detail, I have written about it in my 2016 book on the confluence of Gandhi and Martin Luther King Jr. There Gandhiji, yes, was racist. Let me start with that assumption. Why am I saying this? My source of reference is two newspapers of contemporary South Africa. One is Pretoria Times, another is Durban Times. Now, you know, I was working on Gandhiji and, you know, his behavior in South Africa. And then I went to Johannesburg archives, and there I found these two newspapers. There are many other things which I got from that archives while writing this particular book. It is true that Gandhiji practiced racism when he was in South Africa. As far as sources are concerned, if you believe them, now I don't have sources to cross-check it. I went to check the jail records, but I couldn't find it. I was not, in fact, allowed to go there to check the IB reports. But as far as that newspaper report is concerned, I'll give you two instances to show that Gandhiji practiced either consciously or unconsciously racist prejudices. On one, you know, when if at that point of time, South Africa, there are three lines for going to restaurant, for going to post office, for going to school, colleges, everywhere, for getting into the bus. One for the white South Africans, one for the coolies, Indians, and one for the Samis, local South Africans, the black South Africans. Now, Gandhiji opposed it. Gandhiji opposed it by writing many letters to the governor, to England, saying that you cannot equate us with the Samis. Because before Gandhiji wrote, there are only two lines, one for the white South Africans, another for everybody, including the Indians. So Gandhiji didn't want to go with the Samis, saying that, you know, I'm educated. I can speak English. I'm part of the British Empire. I'm as good a citizen of the British Empire as anybody else. So why do you segregate us from you? Or why do you club us with the local Africans? They are dirty people. They don't know English. They speak in what is called local languages. I'm forgetting the name of it. They have local language. That's not English. That's tribal language. So he said, you know, you can't differentiate us from you. And with Gandhiji's kind of, you know, campaign, now after that, you know, and not at now, I'm talking about then, there are three lines, one for white America, white South Africans, second for Indians, and third for Samis. That's one example. Second example, Gandhiji was arrested. And Gandhiji was put along with the Samis, the black South Africans. Gandhiji didn't like it. Gandhiji said, how will you put me with the Samis? I am so clean. I am so educated. I have got all the qualities which white South Africans have. In fact, I'm more qualified than the local people, local South Africans. So why do you place me with the Samis? Again, you know, he fought in the jail, and he was given a separate cell along with his all Indian colleagues. Now, with these two examples, you know, the Ghana students of Ghana University, they say Gandhiji was practicing racist. He didn't support the local South Africans. Now, to this, I counter. Because, you know, it is if you simply blame Gandhiji as a racist on the basis of these stray examples, I think it will be a little unfair on my part to examine or to understand Gandhiji. Now, don't forget that Gandhiji was nurtured in an era of enlightenment. Gandhiji was educated in India, which was colonized by the British, went to London to do his Bharat law, which is also, you know, product of enlightenment history, came back to India, where the enlightenment stories continued. So he imbibed all the enlightenment values. And one of the important features of enlightenment values happened to be this kind of segregation on the basis of education. Because Gandhi was educated in English language and got Bharat law from London, he thought he was different from those who can't speak English or who are not as educated as Gandhiji himself. So to me, Gandhiji reflected the prejudices of the age, an age which was informed by the Enlightenment principles, which evolved, you know, from the 13th century onwards in England, you know, starting with Locke's, the social contract model. Locke, then Bentham, Spencer, John Stuart Mill, James Mill, John Stuart Mill, you know, that tradition. So they were the ones who developed enlightenment model. So Gandhiji, being product of this enlightenment phase of human history, nurtured some of the values or prejudices, you can say now with hindsight, not just some of the values or prejudices, if you assess Gandhi in today's context, because he was born and raised in that environment. So I think, you know, it's difficult. It is very difficult to simply put Gandhiji under that category to me, because he was certainly a very intelligent person. He knew, and he was for, humanity. So in that case, I don't think, you know, it is very easy. It is not an easy kind of task on the part of academicians to say that Gandhiji was a racist person.
Thank you so much, sir. There is one more question from Dr. Kaushik Ghosh. Why did Gandhiji utter "Hey Ram" while departing this mortal world?
Yeah, you know, this is something which is very which is commonly asked. You know, I face this question everywhere. You know, Gandhiji, if you look at Gandhiji's life, Gandhiji always said, "I am a Hindu." And he said, then asked him, "Why are you a Hindu?" He said, "Because I believe in Upanishads, and I worship cows." So Gandhiji was a pakka Hindu. And if you go to ashrams, you know, Gandhiji either in Sabarmati ashram or in Sevagram ashram, even today, they start their prayer at 4 o'clock in the morning, regardless of the winter. And in the prayer, you'll find hymns for appreciation of Maryada Purush Ram, Bhagavan Krishna. Gandhiji always said, "Hinduism is my private belief." You know, tragedy, what is the tragedy of South, the subcontinent, Kaushik? That the person who believed in Hinduism in public life never utilized his personal predilection in public life. Never. You will find no reference to defend his political position with reference to Ram Rajya. But tragedy, Jinnah, Muhammad Ali Jinnah, was not a Muslim at all. He never ever offered namaz. He always eat pork, which is a forbidden meat for the Muslims. He never said adab, He said, good morning. Good evening. Very, you know, Firangi. Yet, he's the one who utilized religion, Islam, to divide the country. So that's the tragedy of, you know, the subcontinent. The Gandhiji always admired Hinduism. He never used the term Hinduism in case of pursuing his political objectives. But Jinnah was not a Muslim at all. Kafe, he was in terms of, you know, if you think in terms of Islamic conditions, Jinnah never practiced any of them. He used to smoke, he used to drink wine. And, you know, he had many Firangi girlfriends, which is again unacceptable to even Taliban, you know that. So that's a tragedy. So Hey Ram is quite common. It's, you know, it came out spontaneously because he believed in it. But after prayer in the ashram, he never ever used any of the religious slogans to defend his political position.
Thank you for your response, sir. One more question. I think it's the last question from Professor Narottam De, and he has also written that he might be wrong. Sir, I have a query, he has written. For a number of years, I'm a layman in sociopolitical science, but I have read and listened to number of topics on Gandhi Charcha. I also read regularly Swamiji's write-up of Vedanta. And he has again written that he might be wrong. What I feel that Gandhiji's concept is solemnly based on hardcore of Karma Yoga of Srimad Bhagavat and Karma Rahasya of Vedanta. Sir, am I correct?
No, Shumi, no, it's debatable. Yeah. It's debatable. Because Gandhiji, to me, is divided into many selves. Gandhiji was not one self. And if you believe in oneself, Gandhiji being a Hindu, hardcore Hindu, then probably the person who asked this question is correct. But if you believe Gandhiji as an activist, whose main concern was to wrest political freedom from the British rule, there he had to compromise on many of his religious beliefs. So probably, you know, I think he had in mind Gandhi's text called Gita Rahasya, which he wrote when he was in prison in Pune during 1932. So Gita Rahasya, if you read, then Gandhiji, yes, was talking about, you know, Bhagavad Gita as something which is based on Karma Yogi. But if you read Gandhiji's text on Sarvodaya, for instance, which was nothing but a translation of John D. Ruskin's Unto This Last, there you'll find Gandhiji was also, you know, inspired by the existence of non-existence. You know, the existence of non-existence. That, you know, whatever we see in front of our eyes, that actually doesn't exist. You know, high conceptual realization. So, you know, it's very difficult to precisely answer the question, but I would argue that Gandhiji, given the fact that divided into many selves, it is very difficult to pigeonhole Gandhi into one category. He was multifaceted, he was versatile, just like Rabindranath Tagore, just like any of the politician of the nationalist period. It's very difficult to pigeonhole them. That's my response.
Thank you so much, sir. And many of my colleagues have conveyed their regards to you, and they are very thankful for your lectures. I should mention their name here. Professor Shapun Kumar Ghosh, then Dr. Joydev Golda, then N.P. Shankar Narayanan, and Anshuman Chattopadhyay, Debashish Panda, Malay Kumar Laha. So thank you all for your questions, and of course, as a moderator, I'm also overwhelmed this session and the way this entire discussion went up to this actually Of course, we went on and on, but that obvious this discussion was really, I think it is very much, it's much needed. And actually, I request Dr. Nimai Shaha to organize more such things, because there are a lot of insights which maybe academicians, faculties from different disciplines, we all should know and discuss. So thank you very much. At this point, I would request my senior colleague, Professor Tara Prasad Chattopadhyay, to propose a formal vote of thanks.
Yeah, but Moshumi, before I request Tara Prasad, before I allow, before I, you know, Tara Prasad intervenes, I just would like to make one point that, as you know, I was a substitute batsman, and I don't know whether I really did play well, but I was very happy because I wanted to test some of my ideas regarding the assessment of Gandhiji, given the fact that we tend to worship, the heroes of the bygone era. But, I just wanted to find out a rational way. I mean, rational in my perception. It may not be rational according to others, but in my way, to comprehend the conceptual Gandhi. I mean, that was my point. I always saw him not as Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi, but as one who represented an arch of humanity for what is it, treading an untrodden path, which is normally not appreciated. But I'm sure if those who are listening to me get inspired by some of the ideas, at least one or two of the listeners come forward and pursue this kind of argument, we'll be able to understand the nationalist discourse in a new fashion. That's my concern. So if I played my role as a substitute batsman of Justice Radhakrishnan well, and those who listen to me think that it was not a wastage of time for them, I shall be grateful to all of you. Thank you very much.
Sir, thank you so much. I think from the questions and the list of the number of participants and the way the thing went on, and like we started at 4:15 and now it's 6, but somehow we just didn't realize the way the time went by. So I think obviously everybody enjoyed it, and as I said that as a moderator also, as an audience, I also learned many things like many other colleagues. And yes, these are the things as my take from this lecture, that basically I got a lot of insights on supreme humanism to me. So thank you so much. So now, sir, can I...
Please.
Narasimha Babu. Okay. Yes, sir. আগে একটা কথা বলে রাখি শুরু করার আগে, সেটা হচ্ছে আমার নেটওয়ার্ক যদি কয়েক সেকেন্ডের জন্য ব্রেক হয় তো আমাকে ক্ষমা করবেন, আমার নেটওয়ার্ক কয়েক সেকেন্ডের মধ্যেই চলে আসবে আর কি। আমি শুরু করছি, ফর্মাল থ্যাঙ্কস। গুড ইভিনিং এভরিবডি, অনারেবল ভাইস চ্যান্সেলর স্যার, ডিয়ার ডক্টর নিমাই চাঁদ সাহা, রেসপেক্টেড মৌসুমিদি, মাই ফ্রেন্ডস, কলিগস, লেডিজ অ্যান্ড জেন্টলম্যান present in the audience. It is my proud
I think Professor Chattopadhyay's network, yeah, it's creating some issue. And yeah. He will be coming back soon.
Yeah. We can wait a little while.
In today's schedule, there was the speech from Honorable Chief Justice Radhakrishnan sir, but suddenly we came to know that today's Honorable Speaker Radhakrishnan sir is unwell. So it has not been possible to deliver his talk. Under this situation, our Honorable Vice Chancellor Professor Bidhu Chakraborty was requested to deliver a talk on Mahatma Gandhi. Respected Vice Chancellor agreed, and the 40th lecture in Vishwa Bharati lecture series was held without a break. Mahatma Gandhi was not only a freedom fighter, but also a great man with great personality. Mahatma Gandhi had a cordial relationship with Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore. So speech on Gandhi is very much relevant in such a situation. Honorable Vice Chancellor sir is a notable writer on the life and activities of Mahatma Gandhi. Respected Vice Chancellor sir has highlighted various aspects on the life of
Yes.
An extraordinary quality has unveiled many facts which we did not know in detail. During his lecture, he has drawn reference to Sepoy mutiny on one hand, while in another occasion, he has done reference to great physicist Albert Einstein. How Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi became Mahatma has also been focused by our honorable speaker. Non-violence movement in India and Gandhi's fight against racism is well known. It is not possible to summarize the extensive talk in a few words, nor I am able to do that. I offer my wholehearted thanks to our honorable Vice Chancellor, today's speaker in the Vishwa Bharati lecture series, for his informative and excellent speech on Mahatma Gandhi. Next, I must thank Dr. Nimai Chand Saha, who plays a leading role in organizing the Vishwa Bharati lecture series, where many eminent personalities have spoken on online platform. I also thank the entire group of members who have helped much in organizing this lecture. I must thank respected Mousumidi for acting as the coordinator of the 40th lecture delivered by Honorable Vice Chancellor. Thanks are also due to her for selecting and judiciously screening questions on the topic. Thanks are also due to my friends, colleagues, research scholars, students, ladies and gentlemen who are in the audience today. Without active participation of the members present in the audience, the talk would not be so successful. Lastly, I hope your active participation in future lectures to be organized under Vishwa Bharati lecture series. Before closing, I thank you all once again. Mousumidi, please.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Professor Chattopadhyay, for your vote of thanks. And thanks to everyone present here on behalf of the organizers. And of course, Dr. Nimai Chand Saha for such illuminating speeches. And again, I'm thanking our Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir. And hope that we all spend rest of that day in a good manner. And Dr. Nimai Saha, you want to say a few words on this?
We are 6 p.m. onwards. Sir is hurried to join in the music therapy session.
Yeah.
Still, I do have two sentences. I don't found any substitution of today's session. Rather, to me, it's our regular session. I think we must pray before the Almighty for the quick recovery of our Radhakrishnan sir. And at the same time, I am really grateful to Justice Radhakrishnan sir for his kind and gracious scope. That's why we are able to listen to mesmerizing and informative lectures from our Honorable Vice VC sir. So, sir, don't take it as substitute batsman. I think it's a 11th permanent team member batsman you. So we are taking it from that fashion. And sir, this is a formal permission from your side that we need to upload this lecture in our YouTube channel. So I think, sir, you will allow me to do it.
Please go ahead.
Yeah, and Mosumidi, I would like to take this opportunity to request you to coordinate our session when Justice Radhakrishnan sir will deliver his lecture as scheduled today. It will be end of September, like sometimes we will let you know. And we are really grateful to you for such an efficient coordination of this session. So I request you to have your valuable time for the due session of Radhakrishnan sir. When it will be happen, we'll let you know to coordinate the session. So thank you, all of you. And let us allow to sir, leave the meeting and jump up the music therapy program. So thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.